We can talk about pornography as an issue, but that's really a symptom, I think, of the underlying cause. I mean, we really have a spiritual crisis going on, and pornography is one of the ways that plays out or manifests in people's lives.
Just to start off with conversation between us. Ready? Let's light it.
Christian, take one marker. Jason, take two.
I've always wanted to see one of these things. Okay, there we go. Bernie, take three marker.
We live in a pornographic world. It is the wallpaper of our lives. It is everywhere.
You cannot walk through the mall. You cannot turn on the TV. You cannot pull up the Yahoo page. You cannot do anything without seeing at least scantily clad women.
I was extremely naive to what's out there.
Ever since I was young, everybody thought, oh, she's so sweet, and I just had such a mess in my heart.
I was dishonest, and I was not happy with myself, and I was trying to hide it.
I immediately became attached to those behaviors and accepted them as part of who I was.
It was mainly pictures, like softcore, and then it turned into more than that.
I had no clue, no idea that there was an addiction present in my marriage.
Whether it's your husband, whether it's your brother, your cousin, your friend, your son, your sister, someone in your life has that issue.
40,000 respondents to this survey, and the question was asked, who was the first person that you told about your addiction? 62% said they have never told anyone.
They say, oh, you can tell us anything. It was, I can't tell you this. You don't understand. I cannot tell you this. And it was crippling for me.
Now, in the Christian tradition, we're really all connected to one another. If anyone's struggling with this, we're all struggling with this.
If there is an individual that's suffering from a chemical addiction, as a society, we are open arms. But when it comes to pornography, we shut down.
I could go to church and I could swear and people would just kind of go, ugh. But if I say the word porn, man, everybody's like, I've tried it, both things. The swearing went over better.
There has to be a paradigm shift in the way we look at this addiction.
We all need healing. We all need community. We all need to recover a sense of who we truly are. This is a journey we're on together.
We see it on TV. We see it in movies. We hear it in the lyrics of songs. We see it on MTV. We see it on computers. We see it on billboards. It really is everywhere. And it really is portrayed as pretty normal.
They're constantly telling that it's harmless and that it's fun. Harmless and fun. And
natural.
Natural, healthy. Right? Exactly. And the research is showing that it's not.
If you're not looking at pornography today, you're not aware of the level of violence and just demeaning, degrading imagery that's involved there.
My whole mentality about what pornography was and what it meant, I think was very shame-based, very black and white.
In our religion, we're taught to strive for the ideal. We're taught to be perfect, and I think we have perceptions that some people really are perfect.
The final obstacle to true Christian community is the inability to be sinners together. If a person shows up to church and sees all around him or her perfectly well-adjusted, happy, normal people with no problems, no sins in their lives, they know they've got to keep it quiet because the other people would be horrified if they found a real sinner in their midst.
We want people to think certain things about us. We want them to believe we're a certain person, one way in church and another way outside of the church. And so we never have integrity. We never live the way that we should, with people seeing both the good and the bad. And the church really struggles with that because we want everybody to think that we've got it all together and we're good, and the reality is we're not. And guess what? That's okay.
To me, this is it's a complete reversal of what church and Christian community is all about. We show up to worship together precisely because we're all broken. I really feel like in my own church experience, that's largely been lost. I don't feel like people talk that way and act that way. But if we're going to address deep human brokenness, we have to have both a recognition this exists, and there are people in our midst who we'd never suspect that struggle with this.
My first exposure to pornography was 6 years old.
I was in junior high.
Pornography was a part of his life when he was 6, 7, 8 years old.
God, I was probably only like 9. And I was at a sleepover.
I was rummaging through my grandmother's house.
I found a magazine.
I happened upon it doing a harmless kid thing, looking for cardboard boxes to make a fort.
I was researching for a school project and found a video website that had a bunch of scientific videos on it. And one of the videos was a porn video.
It was kind of a neighborhood tradition to find those secret areas that there is pornography. When the parents are gone, we would just watch videos and look at the magazines together.
We were at a friend's house one time and they brought out a magazine. And I always went the higher route, like, oh, this is kind of disgusting. But really inside, I was just like, wow, that's kind of interesting.
It didn't have any warnings. It just, you just clicked on it and it just played.
That image has never left my mind.
I never knew what kind of sensations those were because I was so young. It was very permanent.
You know, I'm 9 years old. I'd never seen anything like this before. So I explored it, curiosity, you know, you're gonna check this out.
All those images were in my head and those became kind of a breeding ground, I think, for me to have a way of escape.
It was hardcore pornography, and so it was way too strong. It was scary.
The problem with kids being exposed to pornography is they don't have a worldview that they can put this imagery into. Because their minds are still developing, pornography becomes the building block, the foundation through which the rest of life is seen.
Most people that struggle with this usually are exposed to it and get hooked into it in the most insecure time of their lives, which is adolescence.
Much like a young person that turns to alcohol or marijuana in order to manage their stress or their anger or some of their loneliness, they will turn to sexual behavior in order to create the same kinds of dependency upon the internal drugs.
Adolescence is a time where people just need to be reassured that they're going to be okay, that they're enough, that they fit in somewhere. And there's constant reminders that they're awkward and they don't fit in and they don't know where they are. And so when they start experiencing the relief that pornography brings momentarily, it becomes a hook.
I started with, you know, feeling dismissed by somebody and feeling unimportant. And then the only thing that I knew would make me feel better for a short amount of time was I would go to pornography.
Well, my story is typical. 12 years old, you know, the kids at school brought some stuff. It was super exciting. It was like, wow, this is great. And lit a fire of interest. And I think the fact that it was forbidden made it more alluring.
For me, I think part of the allure was that it represented something that seemed like freedom. And I grew up in a home that there wasn't much freedom. So seeing these people appear so free, there was a draw there.
I began to sex chat in chat rooms, and it filled that need of having that connection and having men desire me and having men pursue me and feeling like I belonged and I was acceptable and I was beautiful. And pornography kind of became almost research to be able to do the sex chatting better. Eventually, it just transitioned to I didn't need the emotional connection anymore. I didn't care. And I just went right into pornography and never went back to sex chatting again.
I was about 20 years old and I started dating somebody who regularly watched porn movies, and then I just eventually started watching them with him. I was just curious, and then it just turned into something that we did together.
It's extremely shameful for men, but it's even more shameful for a woman to come forward and admit that she has a problem with porn.
In the church, there's this overlying excuse that says, oh, well, boys will be boys. Men are visually wired. That's why they struggle. When a woman hears that, it makes her wonder, well, then what's wrong with me?
I really didn't know, you know, what we were dealing with here. All I knew is that it was fun, exciting, alluring, and it gave me, again, that transcendence beyond the here and now.
It seemed like it enhanced our relationship. Looking back, it didn't, but it felt fun, like a fun thing to do.
When I found myself not involved in anything, or just at downtimes, you're just tired, or really even stressed out at times in life, you just sort of looked for that escape.
After I wasn't with him anymore, there was actually several years that went by that I didn't use it at all. And then I got married, and after that, I had my first baby, and I don't know if it was because I was depressed. I don't know what it was. Within the year after he was born is when I started looking at it again on the computer this time, and that's when I became trapped in it.
Progression for me progressed into viewing pornography and then into masturbation as an early teen. And all this time, not understanding the potential damage that it was doing to my future possibilities of relationships and how I was going to feel about myself later on.
Part of adolescence is that they think they're invulnerable. They cannot see that they are laying the groundwork for addiction, and they don't see the long-term consequences of these behaviors whatsoever.
Inside, I knew it was wrong. I didn't realize then how much it would impact me later.
Absolutely did not see the danger. Was completely oblivious to the danger.
They'll get on the internet and they'll look at supermodels, and then they'll look at the Sports Illustrated swimsuit stuff, and then they'll, you know, it kind of starts pretty tame and soft porn, and then it's like, well, then they want more and they want more. So that tolerance level seems to develop.
We all know that, you know, with porn comes masturbation. I mean, you got it, they go together. So sure enough, you know, every young guy's sort of grown into that phase in their lives. It created a lot of shame for me, especially as a kid who was sort of becoming a person of faith and going to church and starting to learn about God.
And a lot of women will even think that they're lesbians. They don't want to be, but they just think, if this is a man's problem, and only a man's problem, but I have this problem, then I have to be wired like a man.
At one point, I found myself just looking at the women. I thought, what am I doing? I, you know, never been attracted to women before. Why am I focused on them? And then I started questioning my sexuality.
It got to the point where I realized that I wasn't in control of it anymore, and it was controlling my life, and it was destroying me. And that's when I began to panic and think, what have I done?
One of our good friends, we were interviewing him about his addiction to pornography, and he had also gone through a severe addiction to chemical drugs. And we asked him which one was harder to quit, hard drugs or pornography. And without skipping a beat, he said pornography.
An addiction follows a predictable pattern. You have experimentation with whatever the addictive substance is. Your tolerance increases after you use it for a while. Then it turns into an obsession. And then you start to have negative consequences. They can be personal negative consequences, staying up too late and not having energy to go to work and function fully and work the next day. You make the commitment to stop doing it, a real firm commitment, and then you continue with the behavior. So the basic definition of an addiction is that there is negative consequences, you commit to stop, and you continue despite your commitment to stop.
I think I sort of lived with that same lie that a lot of guys live with, and that is, you know, if I get married, then the problem will go away. That sort of hidden desire will cease and you'll be okay. And that wasn't the case either. So about 3 weeks in to the marriage, here I am, I find myself, you know, going to look on the search for porn.
I discovered shortly after we were married that I still had interest in looking at pornography. I would still seek to masturbate to relieve emotional challenges and stress. And so I was then back to the behavior, and now I was continuing to hide it from real.
You're gonna experience more shame if you haven't ever dealt with shame or understood how to deal with your emotions. You're gonna feel more let down and disappointed and hurt in marriage just by virtue of being married to somebody who's different than you and has different needs and desires. If anything, being married will actually set you up to be more attracted to pornography. And so pornography is not gonna go away automatically. If anything, it'll be more attractive if you're not dealing with all the ways of learning how to be intimate and connected to a real person.
At the time that Wendy and I had come together, I had known that this was a huge problem in my life, but the sad part was that our relationship kind of became a new addiction for me. And I thought I was set free. I was like, hey, this is kind of cool. I haven't had the desire to look at porn. I haven't masturbated in months and months, and our relationship just seems so great. And I think I was kind of just feeding off of the, you know, the cloud nine experience of being in love and thinking that this is it.
There's a big part of me that wanted to tell her that, hey, you know, occasionally I struggle with porn. I look at it occasionally. But I didn't.
Lots of women will tell me, I asked him even when I was dating, even before I married him, and he said, no, I don't have a problem with it. And then I get married and I find out he has a problem with it. And they're so mad that he didn't tell them. And I asked them, I said, well, would you have married him if he had told you, if he had fessed up before? And they think, and they're like, yeah, I probably still would have married him. So I think the guys think, wow, she won't marry me if she knows I have a problem with this, so I'm not going to tell her. And then when the time is right, someday in the future, I'll tell her.
We never talked about pornography while we were dating. We actually, from the time we met and dated and got married, it was really fast. It was pretty much, I was on cloud nine.
At the time when I started dating my ex-husband, he did tell me that he'd had experience with pornography.
Finding somebody like Nicole was actually pretty amazing. Like, this person, like, seemed healthy, was interested in me.
And at that time, he was actually pretty open about it. He was open about some of the mistakes that he'd made in the past.
And I felt like it was really important, as we're going to be married, to let her know this is what I've experienced.
He, for whatever reason, I'm not really sure why, but he relapsed. He acted out, and I had no idea what to do with that information. None. It was like, is that okay? Can we still get married? By that time, I loved him, of course, so I didn't want to call off the wedding, but I honestly was like, do I call off the wedding? I mean, I did not have the tools to handle it appropriately in any sort of healthy manner, and neither did he.
I remember feeling that I deserved whatever I got, you know, that whether she did curse me or whether she did say it's over, that, you know, I deserved it. I mean, a sense of self-worth was always something that it was dealing with, particularly when it was watching or viewing pornography.
I am sure I shamed him like crazy. I don't even remember what I said, but I'm sure I did, because I didn't know what else to do. He assured me that he was fine, that he didn't want it in his life. It was just one time, one slip up, and I believed him. Of course, at the time, neither one of us had the tools to realize that he wasn't actually in recovery.
I do think that experience made it difficult in the marriage to be able to approach that subject again.
He never told me again. Never, ever again did he tell me that he was relapsing.
I was always scared to open up to Nicole because I didn't feel like she would have been strong enough emotionally or spiritually to really kind of deal with it.
A lot of the times, guys will keep secrets thinking they're protecting their wives from pain, but what they're really doing is protecting themselves from the pain that they're going to experience when they see how hurt their wife is.
There were so many different scenarios that I had set up in my whole messed up fantasy world that it kept me from actually living a life and relationship. So to actually communicate with Wendy, it was like too vulnerable for me to answer what my favorite thing to eat for dessert would be. You know, it's like stuff that had nothing to do with my addiction. It was like to let out any type of truth was so threatening to my medication. I didn't want to reveal anything because if the truth leaked out, the truth might leak out.
When you're interacting at a child's birthday party or you're at church together, or you're taking a walk in the park together, that secret is being held and kept from the partner. And she is interacting with him as if she has all the information. Even though the act of looking at pornography or sexually acting out may only take minutes, the act of keeping a secret is happening 100% of the time.
I wanted to hide from my parents. I wanted to keep it a secret, and I also wanted to continue doing it. I had no intention of stopping it.
And as things went along, there were other times that he was caught.
When they would confront me about it, I would always lie. I would always take that chance of not having to deal with the consequences or the punishments. And so every time I got caught, I would just kind of begrudgingly go through whatever my parents made me do. And then, you know, it was just a learning experience for next time, how to hide it better.
We kept wanting to lock him down. you know, passwords on the computer and watching every single thing that he was doing or not doing and being feeling suspicious. And with all of that suspicion came more and more, we have to fix this.
Eventually it started turning into harder pornography and getting into chat rooms and things like that.
With each time he got caught, there's more and more anxiety of why can't he stop doing this? What is wrong? And more harsh consequences. He needs tougher consequences. We need to tell him meaner things. We've got to stop the behavior.
That just drilled into me that you need to hide this. You need to keep this secret from everyone. Everyone loves you and praises you and gives you attention when you do all these other things. So keep doing those things and then just keep this aspect of your life secret.
He finally admitted that he had had pornography in his past, but that it was in his past and that he had put it behind him, and that it was no longer an issue or a problem. There was no reason to not believe him or to trust him, because I wanted to believe that I could trust my new husband and that I could believe everything and anything that he told me. We never really talked about pornography after that.
So I approached him and I said, you know, I found just this one video on your computer, you know, just one. Oh, I was looking at it because the guys at work were talking about it. It's like, so just the one time, you know, I was setting him up for failure, which wasn't really fair, but, and yeah, just the one time.
When it comes to addiction, they'll compromise anything to be able to get their fix. So it's their jobs, it's their relationships, it's anything in that moment they'll compromise to be able to get that fixed because their brain's been affected.
My escalation went from pornography and masturbation to adult establishments, and the natural progression after a period of time, by the time I was in my early 30s, I had found my way to seeking out prostitutes. So I found myself in a double life.
When I had discovered strip joints and modeling agencies, which are a front for prostitution, it opened up a whole new breeding ground for lies and secrecy and just the shame of not being able to be in an open relationship with my wife.
I was terrified of the thought of anybody knowing. I was very involved in my church and I felt like I was just putting on an act. I actually did get to a point where I could just look at the pornography and not even really think about what I was doing. I shut my relationship down with God. I knew he knew what I was doing, but I just couldn't talk to him about it.
Many people feel cut off from God, but they don't feel qualified to be able to even participate in serving in the body because of these damaging interactions that they're having with pornography.
I really struggled with, you know, being a pastor and yet at the same time having this secret struggle, because it just created a double life sort of thing, and there was a deep sense of, hey, you spiritually you're supposed to lead people. You're supposed to be the guy that's sort of the example of purity and integrity and character and all these things, and yet I just was a mess internally. And then just thinking that how on earth can I possibly stand in front of, you know, God's people and say the things that I say up front and yet privately, secretly, live the way that I do.
I would medicate myself through acting out behaviors and I would feel some relief, and then immediately thereafter, a deeper level of shame, deeper level of guilt, a deeper level of self-loathing.
You just start feeling like a pervert, or you start feeling like, you know, an alien inside your own house, just like you don't belong. I didn't feel like I fit in anywhere without pretending.
And I knew how to give people what they wanted. So at church, I was the perfect Christian girl. At school, I was the teacher's pet and the straight A student. I knew how to play all the different parts in my life, but none of them were real. My genuineness was gone.
You can hide by being almost superhuman, polishing your armor so brightly that everybody's just so dazzled by you that they would never question that you would ever make a mistake. Because they don't believe that if somebody saw the real them, they could ever be loved. So they have to create a fake them, a fake self, that people can respond to.
for the person who's about to look at pornography and says, no one will know, no one ever needs to know, this isn't hurting anybody. It's not only hurting himself, but when he becomes withdrawn, it's hurting everyone around them. And nobody can put their finger on what's going on here. Why we're starting to withdraw from one another.
The opposite of addiction is not sobriety, it's connection. Pornography and sexual addiction is a relationship with the object of the addictions. You turn to that relationship as you would turn to a real person for comfort and connection, acceptance, belonging.
People that experience interaction with pornography and addiction with pornography oftentimes have effects wide-ranging and quite deep in their life. A breakdown in interpersonal relationships, including friendships, to marriages, to family relationships. Breakdown in relationship with God, so spiritual effects.
People who come into me who struggle with this addiction really struggle with self-esteem issues. It's like they're trying to find that connection, but pornography is never going to give them what they're looking for, that false intimacy which it's portraying.
Those choices of hypocrisy caused me to believe that I was less than instead of more than, that I wasn't worthy of the relationships that I had with my wife. I wasn't worthy of the relationships that I had with my children. And so I was not emotionally available as a result.
And I didn't have friends all through growing up because I was so afraid of people getting close to me. And so I would react to people in anger a lot just to keep them back. And I became this very angry person.
And what spouses have told me time after time as they felt that something was wrong, but they didn't know what it was. And what they would say, he felt distant from me. It's really interesting the way that spouses describe that. It's like he was here, but he wasn't really here.
It took a while to feel like something was amiss. I believed him when he said, I have a work thing. It keeps me out late. He forgets holidays or isn't there really in, you know, when you're in the hospital with a baby, you know. And I continued to think, like, he's moving further away and I don't know who he is anymore. You know, eventually it took years to get to that point, but anything I did feel weird about, you don't talk about.
It was within weeks of us returning from our honeymoon. We both hopped into bed and he literally turned to me and drew a line down the middle of the bed and said, this is my side, that's your side. And I laughed about it then, but I didn't know that that was really foreshadowing how the rest of our marriage was gonna be.
I went through periods of time where I lived in doubt of whether he loved me like I loved him. I didn't know, I wasn't sure, because he could be so distant.
It was horrible. It was, I was not a good person. There was no moderation for me in situations. It was either just really calm, cold, or it was like, you know, in their face.
There were times when I walked on eggshells around him because I just wanted him to be happy. I just wanted him to be happy, and he wasn't, and I knew it, and he knew it.
When confronted, why are you not available, I would make the problem about her. Well, I am available. I'm right here. What do you want to talk about? What is your problem? Then, I'm going to speak for her, she would say, what is my problem?
I'll take it.
I can't figure out why I feel like I can't make a connection.
I've got a problem.
I'm here. Are you available? Well, the whole time this game goes on, there is a tremendous amount of harm being done to the afflicted spouse, and she has no clue why.
So for women, they feel like, oh, why can't my love for him or his love for me be enough to help him overcome this? Or why aren't I enough for him? Why does he have to turn to porn? You know, so then the woman does start feeling insecure about her body or insecure about her sex appeal.
I decided to try to become that sexy. I mean, gym every morning at 4, asking him what kind of clothes he liked, dressing to his standard, if you will. He would point out women
on the television or even in public, you'd be like, wow. And so I was working. I was going to get there. There's a lot of blame shifted onto the other partner that it's their fault. It's their fault for not satisfying the partner, and that's why they have a pornography issue.
I thought I was the problem, and so I went out to a bookstore and bought all kinds of books on marriage, books on anger management even, because I thought if only I could not feel angry. Then I can fix it.
He never made me feel less than physically. But he certainly never told me I was beautiful.
I started in that relationship with really high levels of self-esteem, self-worth, as a happy person, and I left completely hollowed out. I was tired. And ugly.
I never wanted my wife to find out. Never, ever, ever, ever. In fact, I just wanted I wanted to be able to solve the problem on my own and that she'd never have to go through that pain of knowing. But as it happens with a lot of guys, eventually you get, you're not able to cover your tracks. The secret sort of comes out.
I thought that I had been caught, and in my behavior, and the way that I thought that I had been caught is in my association, interaction with involvements with prostitutes, I thought that I picked up a venereal disease. So I was filled with fear, with knowing that I could not continue on in the lie and not tell real what was going on because of that fear that I potentially had carried that infection to her. As it turns out, I didn't have a disease, but I had convinced myself that I did. I was tired of the double life. I was tired of the hypocrisy. I did want our marriage to have value and meaning and an emotional connection. I can change this on my own and I'll stop the behavior and just go on with my life. And that didn't happen. That doesn't happen.
I did get a summons to the dean's office after a month and a half of being at college. And I went in and there was a red folder sitting on the table between us, and it was an internet history report from my student account, and it was all pornography. It represented hours of searching in the month and a half that I had been there. And I remember sitting there thinking, what's wrong with me? Because that was the first time that I had really come to grips with how big of a problem this was. She started to talk about how we know this wasn't you. Women just don't have this problem. And I didn't even get a chance to tell her she was wrong.
I prayed like crazy, you know, I'm asking God, hey, you know, I know this isn't cool, but could you just sort of take it away from me? If you just help me get this under control.
I, of course, tried to figure things out on my own, you know, and try to make the road to recovery on my own. And that didn't work at all, you know. Even for short periods of time, it wouldn't work.
I had set some goals that Nicole didn't know about, that I was trying to stop looking at it, and was doing okay. But again, I was trying to do it on my own. And I don't know why I didn't learn my lesson before. That never worked.
Can somebody get better without being seen by others? I don't think so. I really don't believe somebody can really fully heal from this. Now, they might be able to stop their behavior, and they might stop acting out. And I've seen guys go years without acting out. But that deep belief that they're flawed and defective, that deep belief that if someone really saw me or knew this about me, that lives on inside of them. And ultimately, it leads back to slipping and relapsing back into the old patterns. And if you're not replacing that with real relationships and learning how to take risks and open up and connect, then pornography is going to be super addictive once again, over and over and over again.
I had kind of bought into that feeling of doing well or performing well is what is actually your gauge of healing. I really felt like this is great. And so we kind of
And I had it all under control, too. I was making sure that he was going to his meetings, and I was checking the internet browser, and, you know, I was kind of micromanaging his life to make sure he was doing everything that he was supposed to be doing.
And I was following suit with that, going like, okay, what are all the things that Wendy checks for? I got to make sure I do those things. Okay, good. I've got it. And until I had a slip. And slip meaning I had looked at something that I shouldn't have, used it to medicate, and masturbated. So I kept that one silent, that slip. And then it happened again, and I kept that one silent. And it happened again until I was pretty much back into the habit of viewing pornography.
Anyone can stand at attention for a few periods of time. We call that white knuckling, but they're not in real recovery. Because they're not living a peaceful, calm life. They're just grabbing on and saying, that's terrible, that's bad, I'm not gonna look at that. And that lasts for a while until enough stressors hit an individual and then they just cave and then they go into a relapse.
And I slipped into relapse seeing a pornographic movie. I made the choice to see it, and that at that point also made the choice to not talk about it. And I wasn't going to talk about it because I would never go back there. That's why I said to myself, okay, I've slipped. I know better than this. I'm not going to go back there. And I'm not going to talk about it because I'm not going to burden my wife or anybody else with this slip, one-time slip. And, of course, that was not true.
The second time around, it was so much deeper than the first time around. Like, I had felt like I had blown it to the point where I had my chance for recovery. Now it's just pretty much, I got to stick this one out to the grave.
What I wanted to do is I wanted to keep my totally imbalanced lifestyle. I wanted to keep my broken self-image, right? This idea of myself that I wasn't good enough, that if people really knew me, they couldn't love me. And I wanted to keep the fact that I ate really bad food. And, you know, I wanted to keep all my food addictions, and I wanted to keep my chaotic lifestyle and overdoing things, and I wanted God to take this thing away from me.
I never really got to the root of it. I didn't fix that natural tendency I had when I felt disappointed, when I felt lonely, when I felt frustrated, to go to that drug of choice.
At that point, I really felt like my opportunities to successfully recover were basically gone. And what I didn't understand at that point was my heart needed to be very soft. My willingness level to participate in recovery had to be very high. My level of honesty had to be complete. And my willingness to do the work myself had to be in place. Real cannot fix it for me as much as she wants to. As much as I really thought it would be nice to let her.
I just didn't know that it's not possible to change it for somebody else. What I've learned is that when a person has an addiction like this, they have to want change bad enough like they want to breathe.
When they're really serious about recovery, they're willing to do everything and anything that it takes to recover. And they're willing to do everything and anything that it takes to help their spouse feel safe and work towards rebuilding trust. And that was non-existent in my marriage. It finally dawned on me that my husband wasn't really in it for himself.
The irony is the people that want to leave and pursue whatever feels liberating to them at the time almost never find happiness. It may be for a short time, they may feel that thrill, but that goes away. And they find that their life isn't better because they haven't actually gone away from the problem. The problem's inside. You can't run away from yourself. A lot of us try. We try real hard, and we run really fast, but we can't run away from ourselves, and that's where the issue is. It's deep in our hearts.
I gave up. I got back and I thought, well, God, apparently you messed up because apparently you can't save me. Apparently I can't be fixed. And thanks for loving me. Thanks for the attempt. Thank you for God so loved. Thank you for the price you paid, but I've fallen too far and I'm never gonna be able to get out of this. I'm a freak and I'm sorry for letting you down. I'm sorry that you wasted your time, but I'm done. And I started to think about how to get into the industry because I was done playing the game. I was done
being what everyone else wanted me to be and hiding this. And if I couldn't own it and find freedom, then I was gonna own it and just own it.
I needed to be at the bottom of the ocean to really rise up again.
I was arrested, and in a very curious situation, I picked up a woman who was a prostitute, but I had no money, and I had no time, and it was a very unusual circumstance, yet I did pick her up and was immediately arrested because she was being observed. That brought into my story a new dimension, where not only was I involved in this behavior, now I'm criminally caught and I'm going to be charged.
I went from the superstar to a complete loser, low-life pervert. And so it was about as opposite of, you know, as big of a change as I could possibly have imagined.
We felt that it was our fault. We let him down, that he didn't
have the tools and have his needs met. He was alone and isolated and conflicted by these years, almost a decade, of being trapped in an addiction that is merciless. And he was doing that all alone.
After many conversations that you should never have to have with your spouse, they were terrible. I remember walking out of our last counseling session together, what ended up being our last counseling session together, just knowing it was over. For the next 6 weeks, I just waited for the ball to drop, and it was absolute hell.
So the decision to be divorced was primarily mine, although Nicole didn't really put up a fight, and I don't blame her.
And I knew that I had done everything I could do, and it was time to go.
She moved back with her family. And I spent about a good 6 months of misery thinking I would be happier, and I definitely was not. I was not happier, and I don't know, it's a sad day. I wish, well, it doesn't matter.
I've seen a lot of women that will say, this is a deal breaker for me, and if you don't go in and get help, then I can't be in a relationship with you because you're gonna be stuck. So a lot of men will be kind of their rock bottom, and they'll go get help. But there are some that won't. And to those women, I say, you keep coming in and you work on your shame. You work on your ability to heal and your need to have emotional connection so you don't go crazy living with this secret.
I recognized I could not do this. I could not fix it for him, and I could not fix our marriage. Or the addiction. And so I had a major surrender moment where I turned my hands up and towards heaven and said, take him. I just felt that I needed to totally give it to God.
I had spiraled out of control. And so she knew that. She could see that there's something different about this guy. He's here, but he's not really here. What are we gonna do about him? And so she decided, hey, I'm just gonna leave for a while and see what happens.
A person needs to understand the consequences of his choices. And sometimes those need to be made painfully aware. And I think a separation puts it all out there. It's all on the line here. What are you choosing every day? Are you choosing to go deeper into yourself in a self-centered, destructive world? Or are you gonna see the folly of that and begin to come out? And if you're ready to come out, we'll surround you with people to help you do that.
She went into a mode of, yes, she was deeply hurt, but I've got to begin to think about, how do I do life after this guy? You know, he's not trustworthy. He's not holding up his end of the bargain. So how do we do life without him? I was begging God quietly, secretly, I was like, God, please, here we are again. This is years and years and years. Can we do something about this, you know? I'll do whatever, I'll become a vegan, you know, whatever. You know, I'm just struggling with this whole thing, and God, I've been back and forth with this. I've hurt my wife very deeply. I'm sure it's impacted my children and how I relate to them. We gotta do something about this. And so I just sort of said, God, I'll do whatever.
As I asked myself specific questions about what I believed, I ask, do I believe in God? And I would ask myself that question, and then I would say, I do. I believe in God. And then I ask myself, if he knows me, does God know you, Stephen? And I could only answer that I believe that he did. And I came to the conclusion that I feared man more than God. It wasn't until that moment that I made that choice that I was willing to be helped, that God could help me.
You know, if I was talking to a guy who hasn't told his wife yet, and let's say he came to me, and this has happened before, the one thing I say to him is, look, if you want to save yourself years of heartache and trying to restore trust, you go forward now and tell her before there's any getting caught. Because what that's going to do is it's going to set a precedent, which is, I want to get well. I don't like living this way. And I want to protect you. I want to protect our family. I want to take care of this. And I will be motivated on my own to do whatever it takes.
The ultimate antidote, if you will, is that loss of anonymity, to sort of uncover it, shed some light on it.
The adversary advocates hiding and removing themselves from God's presence and from the presence of people that they love. But it's basically, if we take a look at the story of Genesis, that it's God who summons Adam and Eve forward and says, come out of hiding. Let's talk.
There's a lot of judgment and condemnation in society, and there probably always will be. What Jesus wanted to teach us is that it ought not to come from us, because it's not coming from him.
We all struggle. We all have things we're ashamed of. When we talk about it, and we open up about it, and we're honest about it, it gives people permission to come forward and to say, yeah, I struggle too.
And one of the things that we're finding is so useful is to get people out of the shame of speaking about it.
As much as I didn't want to tell my husband and I didn't want to tell other people, once I finally told the truth and exposed all of that, it's like part of that chain just broke off of me. There's freedom in just being honest.
You have to let someone else know. You have to lose the anonymity. And but that was very risky. I don't want to do that. I'm a pastor. We don't talk about this. You know, we can't just walk up in the church and say, well, I got a porn problem. You know, that doesn't happen. That doesn't work.
And a woman at the college stood up in front of all of the women, the female students there, and said, we know some of you struggle with pornography and masturbation, and we're going to help you. And it was completely opposite of what I had experienced before. It was a huge moment for me to have her stand up there and say that, and to say that someone else in this room was probably going through the exact same thing that I was going through, and that beyond that, they were going to be there for me, and that all we had to do was start the conversation with them.
Who could I trust? Who could I turn to? Who could I confess this to? And I thought of one dear mentor, pastor, friend of mine. There's a big part of me that just wished that he wouldn't have answered the phone. I'm just thinking, please don't answer, because then I don't have to do this. But he answered, and I said, hey, can you come over to my house and let's talk? It was right there that I just sort of said, hey, this has been my struggle. The internet, pornography, masturbation, I'm in trouble here.
We were all encouraged to write down just the stronghold that we have, anything that we struggled with. It didn't have to be pornography and masturbation. It could have been anything. And I did not want to write down pornography. I really didn't, because I felt like it was going to be the end. If I wrote it down and it didn't help, then what was left? So it was a battle with my pride, and I was crying so hard. And I wrote it out, and I handed it to two accountability partners that were on staff there. And I left. I didn't even want to stick around. I told him not to read it. One of those women came up to me and she knocked on the door, and I wanted to stop her. I didn't want her to talk first. And I wanted to beg her to please not send me home, to please listen to me, to please help me, that I really needed help and I really wanted help. And she looked at me and she said, Jessica, what you wrote down on that sheet was brave, and we're gonna help you. And it gave me the power in that moment to see. It gave me almost like light to be able to see that I had been lied to for this whole time, that all of that shame was rooted in this lie that I was never going to be able to be rescued, that I was never going to be able to be helped, that no one could ever see who I was past this. That moment was my freedom, because that moment I could turn to the devil, figuratively speaking, and call him out as a liar, because that's what he is, and that's what he had been all of those years.
And it was in those moments, just as I made that confession, that the real burden of the secret was lifted. And so sure enough, from that point on would begin a real serious journey of dealing with it and getting sober and recovery.
I had a really close person that confided in me that they had the same problem. Someone I looked up to, someone that I thought that, are you kidding me? They have this problem? Like, and then
nothing
and then,
touches them.
Yeah, you know, it's something I didn't realize. And so that happened. And then there had just been a couple of things that led up to it that I really was like, you know what? Like, people deal with this, and it's okay to deal with this. But what I'm doing is not okay. I need to deal with it rather than hide it from my wife. And the weirdest thing is, it was the hardest thing I've ever done, but it's the best thing I've ever done. I had prayed for that moment my whole life. For me, it was, this is the first time I can say I'm in the positive. I'm not going back in the negative.
I realized that I am able to speak the truth. I'm not stuck on this track of darkness and deception. Lies and secrecy keep you, of course, in this prison, but not only a prison that you're just stuck in, but one that is going to put you to death. There is a way out. That way out is through speaking the truth, and speaking the truth is so threatening that that seems like death also. And so either way, you have this death experience. And so I was kind of going on, if I can speak the truth, die, and then resurrect through this experience, I can live.
Most women tell me, all women have told me, I can't think of one that hasn't told me, that if you want to protect me, turn on the lights, let me be in reality, because I can handle it, and then I can make decisions about what I need to do. And most women choose to stay and work it out. And this surprises a lot of men. They assume if she knew this, she would totally leave me. But most women will stay and work it out. And so it's worth taking that risk and giving her the chance to be real with you and you to be real with her and work together on overcoming this.
When Ryan told me that he struggled with pornography or that he was in recovery for it, I actually was at ease. I felt like this great feeling of peace because I knew he was being honest with me, and I thought that was a huge, important quality in somebody I wanted to marry.
One of the things that I carried through my recovery was this idea that honesty wasn't just when it was convenient. I really liked Melissa. I felt like we were starting to kind of build something, and I didn't want to build it on a foundation that would eventually be proved false.
I was, you know, mad and sad and every emotion you can literally think of, except for the good ones like happy and smiling. It was very difficult, and I remember just that night not knowing what to do, you know, not knowing if I should change in front of him, if I should sleep in the same bed as him, what I should do. I remember I just went out in the car and sobbed because I don't like to cry, contrary to what you're seeing, but I didn't know what to do, and so I just sobbed in the car. I did consider that night and those first few days of leaving permanently, but I decided that that was not an option for me, and that every night, I would say for weeks, it felt like we would discuss this addiction and discuss the severities of it and what had happened and what hadn't happened, and I realized that I could deal with this and that it was going to be okay and that he could overcome this, and that I had to help him, and I also had to help myself.
You can ask any couple that's been through that process, and they say, I wouldn't wish this on anybody because of how hard it is, but I don't know how we could ever get a marriage this connected. And that's a hard thing to say to somebody in the beginning, to say to them, you know, you're about to get a new marriage if you stay with it, and if you're both really honest and authentic and transparent about this, you will have real intimacy.
My relationship with my husband is so much better. We have that intimacy now in our marriage, and it's growing. We still have a ways to go, but it is growing. We didn't have that before. I didn't even know what that was.
Our intimacy became more real.
It was genuine.
It became more genuine, yeah. And now the relationship that we have is something we never had before.
this addiction doesn't go away because you say, yeah, I have a problem with this, and then you never discuss it again. Communication is the most important thing, I feel like, in our healing process, and I've been able to tell him things that I could have never imagined telling him, things that were probably so painful for him to hear. We're able to communicate about it and express our frustrations and work together, but we've been able to build a better marriage.
Where we are now, I could not have even imagined it 7 years ago. The progress we've made in our relationship is so much more than I would have imagined.
I think when I started to be able to look past myself and to know that I needed help was a huge step for kind of forgiving myself that I couldn't be perfect. I couldn't kind of be the person that I felt like I was supposed to be, which was all really self-imposed.
Eliminate the shame, because the shame is a lie about who we are. Shame says we're bad, we're worthless, we're not lovable, which is a lie about our nature. And so we shift that and we go, okay, I might do things that are bad and I might do things that create pain and I still have infinite worth.
Shame contributes to that feeling that I can't talk about this issue with anyone else, because if someone knows, they're going to know that I'm a bad person.
But that's the reality of it. You're afraid to let anyone know who you are.
We all know that pornography is wrong, okay? That's not a message that a porn user needs to hear most often. What they need to hear is, what can I do, body, mind, spirit, to grow and improve and grow out of this? The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:23, be sanctified, body, mind, and spirit. So that means body, there's physical and physiological things for us to do to grow and improve. Mind, there's mental, emotional, relational things for us to do to improve and get healthy. And there's spiritual. We can't over-spiritualize. When we do over-spiritualize with people, telling them to just pray about it or to read their Bible more, etc., that actually can be a very shaming thing, unfortunately. So let's go for the holistic, biblical, scriptural approach, and that is body, mind, spirit.
When there's a deficiency in intimacy, porn is like the ultimate substitute, and so people go looking for that false intimacy. As people engage with other people, as the intimacy expands, and as people get closer, the desire for porn diminishes, especially in the spiritual world or in the Christian, in the church world. As people engage with others, as they get involved in community groups, as they find deeper connection with their spouses, the desire for porn really goes away.
Recovery is not about sobriety and abstinence. Real recovery is a lifestyle change. It's learning how to do life differently.
If we talk about it in terms of the basics, it's first a willingness. And that willingness often comes from a hitting bottom. And for me, that bottom came when I was arrested and recognized my tremendous fall into desperate situations and how pathetic that really was. I had to decide to get honest. Okay, I decided to get honest. And in doing so, I discovered that all of these lies that I had been told from the dark side about if you get honest, you're gonna lose, I discovered that that was not true. There were consequences, but those consequences didn't mean you're going to lose everything. It means that you're gonna have work to do. Education, information, qualified counseling, involvement in 12-step, a willing heart, total honesty, a willingness to do whatever it would take. And in some cases, that meant being willing to go through some embarrassment. Those things are not easy, but they were part of my pathway to recovery.
You might be able to convince yourself you don't need it, convince yourself you aren't going to look at it. You might even be able to be in an environment where you can't intake any more pornography, but that longing and that hurts and that desire for it is still there. And as long as that is there, you will go back to it. If God doesn't heal that, and if you don't let him move and work on restoring your self-esteem and restoring your beauty and restoring your worth, then you just kind of live your life afraid of pornography and afraid of falling again, and there is no joy. There's no life in that. You're just afraid that you're going to screw up again.
I did not know early on that I needed my own recovery. I thought if he could get fixed, all of our problems would go away. Just fix him, And then I won't have any difficulties, and we won't have difficulties in our marriage or our family. Well, what I discovered was if I didn't work my own recovery, I would live in the past with fear and the betrayal and victim, or I would go to fear every single day, like he's going to act out again. If I had not worked on my own recovery, I don't, even if he was working on his recovery and doing a really great job and moving ahead, I believe our marriage would not have lasted.
I found a counselor who specializes in sexual addiction therapy, and I went into recovery because I knew and I had learned enough by then to know that I needed recovery for myself.
When I wasn't micromanaging him and his issues anymore, I suddenly noticed, like, how many things I was doing to cope, and I was able to, you know, begin a journey of getting healthier myself. And as scary as it was to think I might get hurt again if I stop controlling him, I actually have never felt more loved and more taken care of.
A lot of women will come in and meet with me and say, my husband doesn't want to do therapy, or he doesn't want to talk to anybody about this. He just wants to do this by himself. So I'm here because I'm desperate. And they wonder what they can do to get him into therapy or what they can do to get him to talk. There's nothing they can do to make him come in. You can set ultimatums. You can set, you know, these boundaries. But ultimately, he has to make a decision that he wants to do this and that he's willing to take the risk of being seen.
You don't have the power to control or fix anyone. You have the power and the gift to love people, to forgive people, and to help people through their problems.
One of the things they talk about in the 12-step program is that slip-ups are part of the recovery process.
I don't say, because I have 4 years of recovery, this is never going to be a problem, and you don't have to worry about it, so we can just go on. I say, you know, these are things that I need to keep doing in order to be good.
We know we can talk about it with each other, and we'll be okay.
Before, I always was like, all right, today is the first day when I'm going to be clean from pornography, and I'm going to maintain it for the rest of my life. When I went from that mentality to my ultimate goal is to be clean and free from this problem. And in order to do that, every time it happens, I'm going to be perfect about going back and working on it again.
We're in this together. I mean, to me, that's freeing. That's the start of healing and recovery, and not just for individuals who are deeply broken, but for all of us. Because the messages of recovery for someone addicted to pornography are the same messages we all need.
I had gone to a men's forum group, and they were talking specifically in the area of what do you want to be known as after you're gone? You know, here on Earth, how do you want people to remember you? The things that were playing in my mind was, yeah, he was deceitful, he was dishonest, he was a cheater, he was a user, and he was an abuser. And he had a second chance, and he blew it. I felt like there couldn't have been anything worse. If I could just bring myself to speak the truth now and know that maybe my obituary could say something like, yeah, he was a cheater, and he was an abuser, but he spoke the truth and had redemption in his heart. And God did something amazing with his life and with his family and changed things around. That there could be a new story that was written in my heart.
Sexual sinners, idolaters, people who ran after money, no one wanted to have them at their polite functions, their polite society functions. And yet here are the people that Jesus wanted to be with. And he made it clear why. Because they knew. They knew they were broken. They weren't pretending.
I remember lying in my bed thinking about all that had happened because my story had been in the national media and so forth. And there was a part of me just thinking to myself, man, what on earth have I done? I've shared this story. I've shamed, you know, I've made the church look bad. I've made Christians look bad. What am I thinking? And an enormous sense of peace came over me, and I believe God sort of spoke to me, spoke to my spirit and said, it's all right. I love you. You're accepted by me. And it was in those moments that you know, God said, you're accepted by me. And I said, then that's all that matters.
Because there is forgiveness, you know? I mean, in fact, that probably already was from the beginning, you know? I never had to worry about it, but I did.
I can go through experiences like this and know that it's gonna be okay. I was going through hell, and I knew I'd be okay because I had a savior.
It's not giving up, it's giving in. And I equate that to my savior. And giving in to allowing him to be the one that makes me feel beautiful.
Because God loves me, I can minister to other people. Because God loves me, I can love others and I can forgive others and I can be secure in who I am and what I've done because I know who I am in Christ.
What a blessing it has been to go on this journey with Paul and to be able to be privileged to see firsthand that the atonement truly, truly takes away our sins.
I didn't know for the longest time there was more than just stopping, that God can heal your heart. He's healing my heart. I had no idea that it could be like this, and I just wish I could take that out of my heart and give it to someone so they know how much hope is out there, because there's so much hope on the other side.
I am known. Jesus Christ knows me. He knows me. And there's no part of me that doubts that.
God stepped into our human misery in a very real, tangible, palpable sense in a manger in about the lowliest place in the world. It says something about the nature of God.
Forgiveness is already a given. You are forgiven. Now let's just go celebrate and have the party, kill the fatted calf, put a ring on his finger, right? And I always knew that. But I think until you've experienced forgiveness and until you've been embraced by the Father, after you've screwed up so royally, you don't really know that.
The fracture of the fall was not just between, you know, God and humankind, but then we see the fracture between people and other people, specifically between men and women. But there's also a fracture, again, in each person, their mind, their emotion, their spirit. These are disintegrated. And I think integration is what Christ brings, so we can actually act the way we believe God made us to be. And I think that's only possible through Christ.
I don't think that it's just abstinence from acting out with pornography that God is after. I think he's after a total transformation of the life and a reorientation of the life. It's not just that I don't want you to just stop doing the bad stuff. I want you to begin to really embrace the beautiful stuff and to begin to do life in such a way that brings him glory and that brings authentic joy.
My life is not perfect and I have not done this whole thing perfectly, but I feel like I can show people who I am and I'm not hiding anything from anybody anymore.
In everything that you do, be honest about your mistakes, and if you are able to keep the addiction in the light, it won't be able to survive for very long. I was viewing pornography since I was 6 years old. My only regret is that I didn't come forward sooner.
This is a journey that takes time and takes effort, and it isn't going to happen for you in 3 weeks. And it's not going to happen for you in 3 months. It's going to happen for you as you live your life of recovery.
If we can be the kind of people that recognize weakness and strive to be better, I mean, that's where it's at.
I realize if everyone struggles, I'm not alone. I'm not abnormal. I'm not unique in this sense, which is a really common thought for people who are dealing with sexual brokenness, addiction, and pornography use. I have to keep this secret because no one will understand.
There's that fear of reaching out because of what people may think. When I finally got over that and could actually talk about it, you know, I told my mom, you know, after talking to the bishop, and eventually I got to tell other people that my main message is that there is love you know? Like, because that's all I experienced when I finally came out and told my family and friends.
Find a safe person, and that person exists. Pray for that person to enter your life.
Tell somebody. Just telling somebody is huge.
You can do hard things. You can do hard things. You can go through recovery. You can kick this addiction now.
The pain of just staying in the darkness and struggling far exceeds letting somebody know, you know, what's going on with you.
To be able to be this open with our community about it, it's created a whole new level of healing for us, because it's one thing to be healed in a room with no windows and closed doors with your brothers who know the deep, dark secrets, but it's another to be open and honest with your church, with all the windows rolled up and the double doors wide open, and everyone's still going, praise the Lord that you are tapping into the grace that is given to you. Praise God that you don't have to be bound up and think that you have to lie and deprive yourself of this gift that is meant for you.
When it shifted from I need to maintain perfection to I need to maintain a relationship with Christ so that he can perfect me, then it made all the difference in the world. And so now I don't look at people who struggle as someone who doesn't get it. I see them as someone who does get it.
If our relationships with one another begin to be characterized by vulnerability, trust, openness, intimacy, then we're starting to live out God's intention for our relationships.
A moment at a time, 5 minutes at a time, one day at a time, miracles have not ceased. One day at a time, miracles have not ceased.
So you thought you had to keep this up, all the work that you do. So we think that you're good, and you can't believe it's not enough. All the walls you built up are just glass on the outside. So let them fall down. There's freedom waiting in the sound. When you let your walls fall to the ground, we're here now. This is where the healing begins. Oh, this is where the healing starts. When you come to where you're broken within, the light meets the dark. So you hide.